And all of a sudden, I basically am organizing a road trip with 8 guys, all professionals,
doctors,
optometrists, and we went to see a Lady Gaga concert.
Did you really? Joining us today for our series focused through the generations. We are in a unique time right now where we have 4 generations of actively practicing ophthalmologists, and we are lucky this evening to have Dr. Frank Bowden with us. Good evening, Dr. Bowden. How are you?
Greetings. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm so glad you did this. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask you to just introduce yourself to the audience and just tell them a little bit about you. Even though people pretty much know you, let's give them a little bit.
Fair enough. First of all, I'm Frank W. Bowden III, MD, and I have been in private practice in Jacksonville, Florida for the past 32 years. That followed an 8-year stint in the U.S. Navy as a naval officer and ophthalmologist immediately following my ophthalmology residency training in San Diego at the Naval Hospital. So I have I'm part of the landscape here in Jacksonville, Florida, you can say. I am a cornea fellowship trained surgeon, but my practice now has evolved in that I am now a cornea, refractive, cataract, and glaucoma surgeon, as well as a dry eye specialist. That's pretty much the bane of my existence today.
Well, you know, I think other than adding heart surgery, we couldn't give you anything else. And I think you could probably do that, Dr. Bowden. Well, you've certainly grown. I've known you now for about maybe 15 years. Yeah. And I watched your practice just excel and excel and excel. And I'm so very proud of what you all have done. And especially with your Dry Eye University, it made me so proud. I felt like I was watching my children grow up during that. So it was really beautiful to see. I'm very proud of all of you and what you've been able to accomplish and teach. It's been beautiful to watch everyone learn and grow from that. So I want to ask you a fun question to start off with. If you could pick anyone, alive or dead, to have lunch with, who would you pick and why?
Wow, that's a big one. Hadn't considered that one. I would say alive or dead. I would say probably the man who influenced me the most to actually go into ophthalmology as a specialty training, as a specialty career. And that's an Axel Hansen, who is a Black ophthalmologist at Meharry Medical College, where I attended back in, 75 to 79. And he was the only ophthalmologist on the faculty at the time, but he inspired me as being just a polished, a very sharp, a very elegant, eloquent man who just exuded confidence. And as an impressionable medical student, I basically said, I want to be like him.
I think you made it. Well, you'll be happy to know that you are being shot or zooming into Nashville. We're right in the heart of Nashville. I forgot that Dr. Bowden went to college at Meharry.
Yeah.
So we've talked about that a lot because I grew up in Hendersonville and I've moved back to my roots. So I'm back home. Yeah. So awesome. So you're going to be broadcast from here. How fun is that? Back in your home ground. Yeah. Tell me about a memorable patient case. It doesn't have to be a surgical case, but what case comes to mind when you think of your most funny or pleasurable or memorable or meaningful patient case?
I've got so many. I'll give you a couple brief. One of which is a patient who trusted me so much that after their corneal transplant, they had an accident at home. It was an elderly lady. Funny lady, but very trusting. And she fell at home, hit her eye. And on a Monday, she basically called my office and insisted on seeing me. And I was in surgery, and she basically decided, you know, I can't see out of the eye, but I think I'll wait for Dr. Bowden. So she came in the following day with my technician telling me she only can see light perception, but I think her cornea transplant's gone. And as it turned out, I couldn't believe it. So I walked into the room and there she was with an open globe. Her corneal transplant was totally missing, gone. I was looking directly into her ocular cavity. And she was basically trying to make light of it and had no idea how serious her situation was. I thought she was gonna have an expulsive hemorrhage right there in the spot. And she started giggling and I just told her to stop giggling. The clothes are on. And I had to take her to an ambulatory surgery center in the floor below and suture a temporary keratoprosthesis into the cavity because there was no donor tissue available. And as I was looking in her eye, I mean, her vitreous was dried. I could see her optic nerve, blood vessels were pulsating. It was the most unbelievable experience. And the following day I was able to get donor eye tissue and suture a new cornea in place and the like. I've seen this lady now for the past 25 years. She still has her eye. She has 2400 acuity. And I sutured in an IOL later. And we're just lifelong friends. And she's just a treat whenever she comes into the office because
she's amazing.
She just made light of a dire situation. And I was fortunate enough not to have a terrible, result of her having.
Wow.
The second patient I would mention was a child that I did a corneal transplant on at age 6 months of age, born with Peter's anomaly and with the variant in which her lens was spared. And so she had a more favorable prognosis than most, but it turns out at 6 months of age, she was just a cute little kid. And I had a picture made with her, holding her in my arms with her mother by her side. And I've basically taken care of this patient for the past 22 years.
That's amazing.
And she was sharp as she wanted to be and highly motivated. And she finished high school. She went to Jacksonville University and got a degree in international, business, politics, and Braille, whatever. And then I found out that she got accepted to Georgetown Law School, in which she's currently a second year law student.
That is wonderful.
Yeah, and in one eye, she has the original corneal transplant that I did. And in the opposite eye, she's had a couple of grafts, a DSAC, and cataract surgery and the like. She's had a more problematic course with glaucoma and the like, but she still has her eyes. She has limited vision that the educational system has basically made provisions and allowances to enable her to excel. And it's just a joy to see that I've had a role in her development. And of course, she considers me part of the family. And it's just a joy whenever they come in the office. So to have longitudinal care of patients with and specialty care on top of that has been very rewarding.
Isn't that great? Yeah. Those are some good stories. How lucky. Well, that's so great is her attitude. I mean, she just kept going, yeah. Nothing stopped her. See, that's so important. Dr. Bowden, in hindsight, what is there anything differently you would have done in the path that you've taken?
You know, I don't think so. I went to medical school with the intent of, being a provider and as well a independent provider. Back in Knoxville, Tennessee, when I grew up, there were four Black medical doctors and they were all independent, all, managed their own practices and the like. And my parents were friends with them. My mother was a nurse. And so I had that contact with Black professional healthcare professionals. And so when I went to school, went off to school, I fully had the expectation that I would be trying to prepare to have my operation, my healthcare delivery system, you know, operation. And so it has been very challenging, daunting at times to be the entrepreneur healthcare provider and, you know, match business acumen and growth and the like with professional development and growth. I mean, my profession has evolved over the years, and I've tried to stay up with it in the developments in cornea, glaucoma, and cataracts and refractive over the years. And it's been just an amazing journey, if you will, that I would trade nothing for it. I mean, to be a refractive surgeon and to say that I've actually done RK surgery back back in the 80s and 90s, and to now do femtosecond laser assisted flat LASIK surgery and implantable, you know, collamer lenses, and to manage intact, you know, manage keratoconus with intact cross linking and the like, where I used to uniformly do corneal transplants.
Yeah.
You know, at one point I was doing over 120 transplants a year, and that's, you know, that's changed dramatically with the innovations that are, you know, available, that I've stayed up with and evolved with the technology and with the profession.
I know, that's amazing. I actually, you probably remember Case Bear's course on RK.
Yes.
I went to his course, and I actually did RK on a pig's eye. Scared the living life out of me to do that, but I had to do it. It's amazing, more amazing to me that people actually let people do that to their eye.
Exactly. I still have a few of those patients in my practice still today.
Yeah, I know some doctors who just have them come in too, and it's like, wow. But yeah, it worked, and it was what we had, you know, it was the latest innovation. So we grabbed it and ran with it. So you've always been a solo practitioner.
Yes, I've joined a multi-specialty, multi-ophthalmic specialty group between 1990 and 2000, and it was a good experience. It was a group of competitors that joined to deal with the looming threat of managed care in our community. And we were scared. The prevailing discussion at the time was that private practice would be a thing of the past. And if you weren't a part of a group or an organization, you were going to wither on the vine and not have any access to patients. And it took a bit of courage to join a group, band together. And it was a bunch of great guys, but not everybody was on the same page, if you will.
Yeah. Not ophthalmologists. They always agree.
it was a tough 10 years. And and afterwards, we all saw the light that we would do better and be happier if we established our own individual practices.
And so
in 2000, I established my practice, Bowden, I and Associates, and basically started acquiring optometrists and fellow ophthalmologists. And back in that time, created an integrated eye care practice in which we had collaborative, work with optometrists, ophthalmologists, and opticians, and providing full range of service. And at that time, it was very important because I was consultant ophthalmologist for the Jacksonville Jaguars football team, and we needed to have the full range of services to provide for them, from refractive to comprehensive eye care to optical and the like. And so that was, I think just a nice introduction into what is now a prevailing eye care model that is working out very, very well for us.
You absolutely are a prevailing model. I absolutely know that. And I was at one of your OD meetings, so I know how well attended and how gracious they are, and how respectful they are of you and your talent, and you of them as well. It speaks very highly. I want to ask you, what do you do in your spare time? You don't have any spare time.
I don't have any spare time, basically.
If you have any spare time, Dr. Bowden, what would you do?
Yeah, well, I usually spend it, you know, playing tennis and working out and trying to maintain some sort of balance physically, because you have to have a lot of stamina to, you know, maintain a busy ophthalmic practice schedule and life and the like, and balancing with, you know, the home, family, and the like. That's I've struggled with that, I'll admit, that my generation basically made sacrifices for the good of the practice and the like, that probably my younger colleagues would not have made, you know, at this, or wouldn't make at this time. But I look back and say I did what I thought was best to, as I say, keep the boat afloat, to keep growing the practice and maintaining the branding and being available and seizing opportunities when they arise, and maintaining development and of clinical knowledge and surgical skills that were necessary. I mean, for example, back in the day, in order to learn new surgical procedures, you had to travel to another practice. You had to visit other surgeons. Unfortunately, I've had some wonderful, gracious surgeons who have welcomed me into their practices, their homes, their lives, and I've made lifelong friends accordingly. And it's been, you know, just great, you know, to be able to have that kind of a journey. So I wouldn't have, I have no regrets. I feel like I'm the luckiest person in the world to have the profession and a career that at my stage of life, I look forward to coming to work every day.
See, I had a wise man once tell me, and you'll know him, Dr. Manas Kraft. So his kid, yeah. If you ever find a job you love, you'll never work a day in your life. And he's so true. I found my love too. So I know how you feel. So what would you say to those upcoming, and you have quite a few of those in your practice as well, yes, that next generation and the generation even below that, what would you say to them coming up and how to build their life and their practice? And, you know, they're a little bit different than when you and I came up through the ranks.
Yeah, I think there are a couple of things, one of which would be to, you know, understand who you are, understand what it takes for you to be happy, and kind of define how you want to position yourself in the field, as an educator, as a clinician, as a high volume surgeon, you know, and the like, and just kind of figure out if that's a long-term model that you'll be satisfied with. In my particular situation, I have enjoyed longitudinal relationships with patients, families, and the like, providing, you know, specialized care, and it's been you know, unique for me to enjoy that. I know I have some colleagues who would find that just very undesirable, you know, treat and street and move on to the next patient, yeah, you know, and the like, but that's, you know, that's okay. The other thing I would say is you want to stay current, maintain engagement with colleagues, go to professional meetings, stay current, don't be afraid to invest in yourself. Don't be afraid to invest in your practice. You know, I've probably taken home less income over the years because of my continued drive to make sure that we maintain the best of technologies in our practice, and that we, you know, implement those innovations and developments that enhance patient care, solve problems more effectively than in years past, and improve patient satisfaction and the like.
Okay, I have to have a funny story. So give me something that's happened on your travels.
Oh, well, one of the things I like to do is if I work hard, have that mantra, I like to play hard. So one of the things that I decided to do about 10 years ago, when I adopted another mantra, life is short and I'm old. So if I find something I need to do or want to do, I got to go for it. So I basically organized an all-guys trip to a concert after first asking my wife if she would attend it.
If she would let you.
No, I wanted to take her.
She wanted to be the only woman on that trip.
There you go. I was going to take her alone. And so when I told her who I wanted to see in concert, she shot me down with a not only no, but hell no. And I thought, you know, I really want to do this. And so I started chit-chatting with my anesthesiologist, my family doctors, my tennis buddies, my ex-medical school classmate that's in the area. And everybody was like, hey, I'm on board with that. I think I want to do it. And all of a sudden, I basically am organizing a road trip with 8 guys, all professionals.
That's doctors, a scary road trip. Optometrists,
and we went to see a Lady Gaga concert.
Did you really?
In 2011, we had a stretch limo. We partied all the way from Jacksonville to Orlando to watch the concert. And then we had dinner. We went out after the show. We had a good time. And then came back in the dead of the night, arriving back home at about 5 in the morning. And because this was kind of like a hall pass for all of us. I think half of us were married, you know. So it was a hall pass for like 14 hours. And it was the most fun ever. And I'm walking around and at the concert and people are just kind of having a good time. And I'm walking around thinking, gee, nobody knows I'm a doctor. This is great. It was the most liberating experience ever. And everybody was just, it was just a fun atmosphere and the like. And one of the text messages I got from one of the attendees was of our group. He says, I haven't had this much fun since I was 10 years old.
Wow. You guys need to live.
It was epic. It was so, we were the talk of the medical staff for a good number of years. Many of the people wishing they had joined us. It was funny.
Lady Gaga. I got to remember that one. I can't imagine you in a Lady Gaga concert, but I'm really glad you did.
Hey, life's short. I'm old. Got to go for it.
I'm thinking at least, you know, it could have been Cher. I mean, that would have been my guess. But Lady Gaga, yeah, that's one up. Good going.
I know. It was visionary.
I love it. I've got one final question. And I know Patty told me I have to let you go because you have a meeting. So I'm not going against Patty. How have you seen technology in ophthalmology transition through your career? And where do you see it going in the next 10 years?
I was just thinking one of the biggest impacts of modern technology has actually been in the sphere of education. When I reflected earlier on what it took for us to stay current in terms of going to annual meetings and visiting other surgeons and the like, now information transfer is so rapid, so effective with our ability to get electronic media to disseminate information, knowledge, clinical studies, evolving to surgical techniques and the like. Now, I mean, as you try to access a new surgical procedure, oftentimes you go to iTube and look at your colleagues' videos and never leave your office or your home and feel just as empowered and prepared, to get your wet lab experience if necessary and feel confident to take care of patients with what you've learned. And that, I think the ability to disseminate knowledge, to collaborate with colleagues around the world, it's just mind-boggling. It's something I never really appreciated outside of our international eye meetings that we used to go to. And I would go to all of our meetings annually, you know,
Yeah,
two
I
meetings
know.
plus the regionals and the like. But that's probably one of the biggest innovations. Obviously, the technologies with lasers and the like I've followed, embraced, and managed and utilized. And it's just amazing how we're able to take care of more problems with less patient morbidity and more success and better outcomes and better patient satisfaction. It's been wonderful to observe all of this over a 30 plus year, you know, experience in private practice.
I agree. I think it's information. That's a new one. No one has said information for technology. So that was, you brought out a new one for me, but it's brilliant because it's so true. I remember, you know, getting the VHS tapes and sitting with my surgeon while we watched these things over and over and then going, you know, and putting it into practice. And yeah, so, and now you're right. You just bring it up on the computer, you watch it, you know, do it. Wet lab is right there. And then you just go do it. It's pretty cool.
It really is.
Well, Dr. Bowden, thank you so, so much for being with me this evening. I love you, and I'm just so thrilled and honored that you would agree to do this for us. And Vision Care Connect thanks you, and I thank you.
Well, I appreciate it. It's been a privilege and an honor, and I thank you for the opportunity.